Mr. Chairman, Congressman Payne, other members of the committee, thank you so much for holding this hearing and for the great interest that I know you have for this situation. As you well know, and you know it from the testimony so far, we face a very serious situation right now. And I would ask that my full testimony be put in the record because it has a great deal of information on the background to these events that I hope will be helpful to the committee. But I want to focus in this presentation on where we are. We were relatively optimistic after the referendum of January 9th, but in fact, in recent months, there has been more tension between the parties, and we could see that coming in a number of ways. In Abyei, there was a growing frustration by the population. There was a blocking of the migration. There were forces introduced contrary to the agreement, forces from both sides, and tension was building up there. We have been working nonstop on these issues all through this period, and that includes the more recent events in southern Kordofan. From the time that the Sudanese forces moved into Abyei, we have been working around the clock to mobilize international opinion in support of the withdrawal of those forces. And from the President, from the Secretary of State, from others in the administration, we have urged people, you know, that we don't have direct contact with President Bashir, but we urged many, many leaders from around the world who do to call him and to say that they are risking a great deal by doing this. I came just this morning, I had just this morning a meeting with President Obama where we discussed this situation. He is deeply concerned. He follows Sudan events daily and, of course, is very concerned not only about the situation in Abyei, but about what's happened in southern Kordofan. The Secretary, as you know, was in Addis Ababa just this week in meetings with the parties. And let me say where we are and what's happened in this in response to this crisis. On Abyei, we recognized that the situation was growing very dangerous at the beginning of May. And we, I and former President of Burundi, Pierre Buyoya, and the Secretary General's representative, Haile Menkerios, immediately flew to Juba, and we worked with both parties to resurrect an agreement for the withdrawal of forces from both sides that both had signed but had not been implemented. We were moving that process forward when a second incident of attacks from the SPLA on a joint integrated unit triggered what we feel is an extraordinarily disproportionate response by the government to move its forces into Abyei. Our efforts on Abyei have been to get an agreement as quickly as possible on the withdrawal of forces from Abyei. To do that, we needed to strengthen the UN force in Abyei, which had been ineffective in both monitoring fully the introduction of forces that violated the agreement and in preventing the events that took place when the Sudanese forces came into the territory. To do that, we have asked Ethiopia to bring their troops in to the UN force, because they are willing to enforce the mandate that UN operation has. There's been long and sometimes painstaking negotiations on that, but I can tell you, particularly thanks to the Secretary's intervention earlier this week, we are fairly close to an agreement that would have the Sudanese forces withdraw from Abyei, a reinforcement of the UN force and a new administration in Abyei. It's not sealed yet, but it's close, and we're hoping it'll be signed. Now, on southern Kordofan, You've heard a great deal of the testimony on that, and you know that we face an extraordinarily serious problem there. The fighting has broken out. There are reports of very serious human rights abuses, which you've heard about, and there's a serious humanitarian situation for anywhere from 40 to 60,000 people who are displaced as a result of the fighting. I had been to Southern Kordofan several times in recent months in the lead up to the election there, and have been in regular contact by phone with Abdulaziz, who is the former deputy governor and the leader of the SPLM in South Kordofan, trying to avert this kind of situation that broke out. Under the auspices of the Africa Union high-level panel, negotiations to resolve this immediate crisis have been going on also in Ethiopia. And an agreement is being put together, but yet is not as close as the one on Abyei. A delegation just flew by helicopter into Southern Kordofan in spite of the fighting, a UN helicopter carrying members of the SPLM and a member of my staff and the AU panel to meet with Abdulaziz and to work further on the agreement, and in particular, to get an agreement that covers several things. First and foremost, we want a cessation of hostilities and full access for humanitarian assistance to those who have been displaced. Second, and this has been worked on, an agreement that the political grievances, which are at the source of the conflict there, get fully aired and negotiated between the NCP and the SPLM in an organized way in the future. And third, an issue which in part touched off this this conflict in Southern Kordofan, a committee to look at how you eventually integrate the SPLA forces inside Southern Kordofan, which as Roger Winterman noted and others, are people who come from Southern Kordofan. They are not Southerners, and they're looking for their place in that state. Abdulaziz, as a result of this mission, has agreed to a 30-day ceasefire on certain conditions, and now we and others have to work to see if we can get that done. This is the efforts we've been making throughout the administration over the last several weeks to arrest what has been a deterioration in the whole process of the Comprehensive Peace Agreement. And there are outstanding issues that need to be resolved by July 9th. First, of course, is Abyei, the future of Abyei, a most contentious issue, and I know members are very familiar with that. There is the second question of how the proceeds from oil from the south will be apportioned during a transition period, and the conditions under which that would take place. There are issues of citizenship that have to be resolved, issues of disputed border areas, and a few others. There have been lots of discussions of these issues. A lot of technical work has been done. But what we haven't got to are the political decisions now that will resolve many of these issues. Those negotiations were supposed to start this week, but of course all of us have been diverted to dealing with the crises in Abyei and Southern Kordofan. Let me take a moment also to deal with Darfur, because as consumed as we are with these current crises and the CPA in general, we are also deeply engaged on the problems of Darfur. We decided in the administration to put a very intensive diplomatic effort in the talks, the peace talks going on in Doha in the country of Qatar. Those talks have been going on for two and a half years without results. My colleague Dane Smith, Ambassador Dane Smith, who works full-time on Darfur, practically camped out in Doha for several weeks with his staff to try and improve that agreement. And we worked very hard to get a second armed movement, the JAM, into those talks with the government of Sudan, and they did engage in talks. The result of Doha is a draft agreement which is better than the one that came out of Abuja, but it's not signed yet by the government or any of the armed movements. The question is where we go next from there. We have to do two things. We have to try and work more with the armed movements on getting them into the peace process. It's not that they don't have grievances, but many of them have said what they want to negotiate is the whole constitutional restructuring of Sudan. They don't want to start with Darfur, and that makes for a very complicated process when you're talking about Darfur. On the government side, we have constantly worked on questions of access respect for human rights. There is a desire and a legitimate one for a peace process that engages many more of the people inside Darfur. But to do that, you have to have conditions in which you don't have a state of emergency, in which people are free to talk, not worry about harassment afterwards, you need security, et cetera. So what we've said to the UN and the Africa Union that want to lead this process, not until these conditions are present. You can't have a process that would be legitimate or credible. So we continue to work on all these aspects of the Darfur problem. It's complicated also, I might just say in passing, by what's happening in Libya. I think you're aware that Libya had been assisting at least one of the movements. The head of that movement, Jem, is still in Tripoli, and what happens in Libya could have an impact on the situation in Darfur, something we're watching very closely. Let me stop there, Mr. Chairman. I know there's much, much more to go into, but I just wanted to give you a quick view of the efforts that we've been making for the last several weeks throughout the administration with President, the Secretary, National Security Council, myself, and others, our embassy in Khartoum, our consulate in Juba, to get at these issues. Thank you very much.